It is for Kevin Conroy's panel.
All love.
So when I went in, I met Paul Dini, Bruce Timm, Andrea Romano.
Yeah!
I didn't know any of them were! So I was completely uninhibited. You know what I mean? I didn't feel any, I wasn't intimidated at all because those were just schmoes. I didn't know them. And they said, well, what's your exposure to Batman? I said, well, I know the Adam West show from the 60s. And Bruce Timm goes, no, no, no! We love Adam West, but that's not what we're doing. Erase that memory. He said, think of films from the 40s. Think of film noir, dark, gritty, Manhattan. It's a tragic story of a child who's watched his parents be killed in front of him, and he lives to avenge their deaths by embodying this alter ego. And I thought, my God, I said, you're describing the Hamlet story. And he said, well, no one's made that analogy before. But I was just using my theater background. You know, I was thinking, this is like Orestes, this is Achilles, this is Hamlet. This is in the scope of those great mythological characters. You know, the ancient Greeks and Romans used mythology to teach morality to young people. And in our culture, I've come to believe, we use Batman, Superman, and Wonder Woman. It's the same thing. They're the same stories. We've just given them a new kind of contemporary American pop spin. But it's still just teaching good and evil to our young people. And then they become such cultural icons that they have a big adult following now, too. Batman the Animated Series was originally a primetime show on Fox. And so that's why the shows are so sophisticated, because it was never created to be a kid's show. It was created really to be very adult. Writers took it seriously, the studio took it seriously, the actors that they hired, you know, from Ephraim Zimbalist Jr. to Mark Hamill, to Roddy McDowall.
Yeah!
Diane Pershing, you know, these wonderful actors, Paul Williams, Ron Perlman, I mean, great actors who were all coming in to do these shows. And they love to do it, Warner Brothers, they love to do, you know, we do the recordings first. I don't know if you realize this, the way that you do animation. The voice people are first. So we get a lot of input into how the stories are rendered. And then the recordings are sent off to the artists. and they paint to what we've acted. And then there's always extra mouth flaps, lines changed, and then so it comes back for a process called ADR, where you sync up the visual with the audio. And it's usually 6 months before initial recordings to when you finally see the artwork back from the artist and you sync it up with an ADR process. So in that 93, when we started doing the show, 92, there were 6 months where we hadn't seen anything, because we'd just been recording like radio plays. And Mark Hamill and I were together in the ADR booth at Warner Brothers to do the first ADRing of syncing the audio with the visual. So it was the first time anyone had seen any of the artwork. And it was on a full screen in a theater. And whoosh, this full symphony score comes up. And these brilliant colors, these strong graphics, and this dramatic, dark, noir New York. And I looked at Mark and I said, did you have a clue that this is what we're doing? His jaw was hanging open. We both were just so impressed at what they'd managed to create. And that's when we started to think, you know, this might be landmark. This might be something that becomes really important. You know, every time you work on a show, you never know if they're even going to renew it for the next season. So to be renewed season after season, and then have the show grow into from Batman the Animated Series to Batman and Robin, and then Batman Beyond, and then Justice League, and then the Arkham games. I mean, it just evolved and evolved and evolved. And it's because of all the effort that went into it in those early years. All the money they put into the artwork, all the effort they put into the stories, the wonderful casts of actors that they put together. They brought in people who've never done voiceover before. I had never done voiceover before. They brought in theater actors and film actors and just, you know, got us all to play together. And they created this incredible world. So now when we look back on it, anyone who's ever been a part of it is so proud of what we created. But it's that thing, you know, there's a wonderful line in a John Lennon song that says, life is what happens to you while you're busy making other plans. Which is basically that it's so hard to plan on what life is going to bring you. I planned on being a classically trained stage actor. But that ended up feeding into creating the role of Batman in the animated show, because he's a classic character. There's something very classic and epic about him, you know, and about the stories. So, and I don't think anyone who worked on those original shows really knew that it was going to evolve into what it evolved into. Even the producers, I think everyone was amazed at how good it was and how but, I mean, the reason this hall is full is because those shows were so good. And it touched you. I have people come up to me at Comic-Cons all the time and tell me the most heartbreaking stories of childhoods that were very difficult. And they'll say, you know, Batman got me through really a horrible home. And I say, wait a minute, you got you through that horrible home. You know, you got you out of that situation. And they'll say, yeah, but I had no other safe space other than Batman in the afternoons. And you realize how difficult some people's lives are, some young people's lives are. And to have that, to have been a part of that safe space for so many people, and their imaginations to develop, and their sense of right and wrong to develop. I can't tell you how it touches me, how proud I am to have been a part of it. So thank you guys, because the audience is what makes that happen, really.
Thank you!
I mean that sincerely. You guys are very passionate about the characters and about the shows. I have people come up to me all the time at Comic-Con and say, you know, in episode 23, when the Joker said, and I'm like, oh my God, I don't know what this guy's talking about. Because he's memorized every show, you know? And I get to remember, you know, what I had for breakfast. So you are an amazing audience. amazing passion. Ashley. What else can I tell you about? What should we ask some questions?
Yeah.
Got a question?
Oh yeah. It's the 25th anniversary, I believe, of the animated series. So what was your least favorite episode and what was your favorite episode of the show?
That's a very loaded question. I don't have a least favorite episode.
None?
None, because they're all Batman. He's just so cool. My favorite of all the things we did, I think, was Master of the Phantasm.
Yeah!
I think, because it tells the whole genesis of Batman. You know, it's the whole arc of his life story. And in that scene, the wonderful thing I love playing about the character is, he's not, you know, square-jawed, cookie-cutter Clark Kent Superman. He's dark, twisted, conflicted Batman, you know? There's so much... Bruce Timm likes to say, well, he's a guy with issues. And he is! He's a guy with so many issues that it's so much fun for an actor to bite his teeth into. It's a fun character to play. And, so Master of the Phantasm, for me, shows all of that. It shows all the darkness of him. And especially when he falls in love with Andrea, he sees this, he finally sees the potential for having a normal life, and he knows he can't. He'll never be able to have a normal life because he's trapped in that drama of his childhood. And he's trapped in that vow he made to his parents that he would avenge their deaths. So he has a wonderful scene at the Wayne tomb of his parents, where he's asking them to release him from his vow. And he breaks down at the tomb. And it's such a human moment for Batman, you know, this epic character, to have this human, heartbreaking moment where he's saying, I want to have a normal life. I want to be a normal person. And it's at that moment that a flock of bats comes up out of the cave underneath Wayne Manor. And he knows he can't. He'll never be able to escape his past. So I think that movie's great. It's just got that whole arc of the show. But I also love anything that shows those conflicting sides of Bruce Wayne, like Perchance to Dream is a wonderful episode. Dreamscape is a wonderful episode. I like all the ones that deal with Batman's psychology.
Thank you, Mr. Carmine.
Sure.
So the Batman's Rogues Gallery, each member of his villains has a parallel to Batman's personality. And I was wondering, which villain do you think would closest resemble your own personality?
Well, I have to admit I am very biased toward Joker. Because of Mark Hamill! So incredible. And who would have known Luke Skywalker, you know? That crazy, crazy, crazy character was inside Luke Skywalker. I love working with Mark. And we both, we're like yin and yang to each other. We just, the better he is, the better I am. The better I am, the better he is. We work so well together. And he's, the wonderful thing about Mark is he's a very generous human being. People forget that actors are people, you know? There are nice ones, and there are mean ones. There are generous ones, and there are selfish ones. There are ones that you want to spend the day with, and there are ones that are really jerks, you know? Mark is just a very generous, very giving, wonderful guy to be in the group with. And he's, I just can't say enough. And then we get going, we get each other going, we have some pretty crazy times. So I love that about Mark. But I really do believe that what makes the Batman world so interesting are the villains. I think you've touched on something interesting. What incredibly crazy villains. I mean, they're whacked out. And that Batman doesn't kill anybody is such a wonderful thing about the character. No one ever dies. He arrests them, and he puts them in Arkham Asylum. And then made Arkham Asylum this crazy, you know, really, you know, archetypical nut house. And so the idea of having the Arkham games, where Batman got trapped in Arkham with every great villain from Gotham City, and that was a great idea. The villains really defined that show in a lot of ways. So from Poison Ivy to Harley Quinn to Bat to Joker to Two-Face and the Riddler. I mean, just amazing villains. Mr. Freeze, that was a great movie too. Sub-Zero,
absolutely
great movie.
Thank you for being back.
Hello, Kevin. 10 years ago, my dad told me that you were going to be at a convention, and I burst into tears because I couldn't go. Because I was in high school theater at the time and had a performance. My uncle actually got your autograph for me, and you wrote very kind words on the autograph. I'm happy to say 10 years later, I'm actually trained as an actor.
Oh, wonderful.
I got a degree. And my question for you is, what is the biggest lesson that you've learned as an artist and actor?
Wow. There are a lot of lessons. I think one of the biggest lessons is to listen. I found if you really listen when you're acting, and I mean really listen to what someone's saying, it completely affects how you respond and how you act. And acting is really about just being open to your emotions and being honest and reactive to what someone gives you. That's why Mark and I work so well together. We're both very trusting of each other. I think the most important thing is to be, to listen, and to be that, oh, I know what it is. Acting is such a difficult thing. Because, think about it, to be a good actor, you have to be able to allow yourself to be completely vulnerable emotionally. That's all acting is about. That's all acting school can teach you. It's how to get in touch with who you were as a child before the world screwed you up. Seriously. And it's just, you know, who you are underneath all the crap the world dumped on you. And it gets you in touch with those childhood emotions so that you can share them. And you can create characters. But the only way you can do that is by making yourself really vulnerable, really opening up to things that may be very painful. They're difficult to deal with. But you're doing all that in a business that is brutal, brutal, full of nasty people. So you've got to have this really tough skin to deal with the constant rejection and the constant criticism and all the jerks of the world, you know what I mean? So think about it, you're developing a vulnerable ability to open yourself up at the same time as you're developing this very tough skin to deal with the business that you've chosen to be in. So I've always looked at a weird contradiction about actors. You have to develop in two directions at the same time. Because no one survives in this business who doesn't have a very tough skin. But no one succeeds in this business who isn't completely vulnerable and open. So how does that work? How does that work? That's why you end up with people like Michael Jackson, who are incredible artists, but who get crushed by the world they create. That happens all the time. You meet these wonderfully talented actors who get crushed, or really horrible hacks who succeed because nothing bothers them. You know what I mean? They're tough as nails, but they don't have any of the vulnerability. It's very, very hard. And the other thing I would say is, no matter what you plan on, your career is going to take another turn. You can't. The most important thing is to be well-rounded and to be educated, because you have no way of knowing what life's going to throw you. No matter what you plan on doing in life, life throws nothing but curveballs, and you have to be able to hit them.
So, coming into that, Byron Beeke here, I've been after the directors and staff for 6 years, going back, trying to get you here.
Oh, okay.
Succeeded. Yes, the world of I just wanted to know, I was looking back on some of your past Comic-Con work, and it's funny, you were making, I just found it very amusing, your assessment of Christian Bale's performance in The Dark Knight, and using that as a focal point to discuss, you know, your method in madness to create a proper, you know, billionaire playboy Bruce Wayne, and then a vengeful Dark Knight. And I just started amusing how you were going over the textures of how he didn't quite hit the nail on the head. He's a great actor, but
he's a wonderful actor. He's a really wonderful, talented, wonderful actor. But the secret for me to playing the character is, well, I found this early on, is that Bruce Wayne, Batman, is not the performance. Batman is what happened to him after his parents were murdered in front of him. Batman is who he is when he's naked. He's raw, dark, brooding emotions. That's who he is. The performance is the suit he puts on every day, goes into Wayne Enterprises, and plays it being Bruce Wayne. That was the take I had on. So it made the Batman voice, the Batman persona, I think, sound not artificial. They made it sound organic, because my take was that that is who he is, organic. And Bruce Wayne was this kind of sophisticated artifice that he puts on. Like we all put on an artifice for the world. Everyone has a public face and a private face. Christian Bale, I think, dealt with Bruce Wayne as the sophisticated, wonderful, wealthy, broody, you know, Prince of Gotham. And he's wonderful as Bruce Wayne. But I think he thought of Batman as the performance. And it sounded that way. It sounded like a weird voice he was putting on. It just didn't seem organic, I think. And that's the way the audience reacted to it. I think, to be honest, Ben Affleck is really getting the best balance of both. But that was just my take on the character. It worked for me. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, thank you. And also, I just wanted to add also, you and Tim Daly were great in The World's Finest.
Yeah. Isn't that great? The best of both back and forth. Yeah,
the best hero.
And if you ever see, you know, Tim Daly has a great podcast called The Daily Show. If you've ever seen one that I did on it, you should check it out. It's really fun. I'm like haunting him throughout his apartment. He keeps like looking over his shoulder and imagining he's seeing me. And he is seeing me.
Thank you.
Sure, sure. Hey.
Hello. I would say it's an honor of meeting and speaking to you in person.
Thank you.
And I want to let you know that you and Mark Gamble have impact my whole entire life, becoming and inspiring me to become an animation myself.
Oh, great.
And I just got done with them in my first year of college.
Wonderful. Congratulations.
But anyway, I want to ask a question that you also find very funny, like any moments where Batman and his Robins, like, they're both like a family coloring thing, but since he's Batman, he's like, protect the city while I'm gone, and then leave.
It's always been a sort of a loaded relationship, that Batman-Robin kind of thing, you know? But Lauren Lester was a wonderful
is a wonderful actor. He's a wonderful guy to work with, creating the original show. And then they spun him off as Nightwing in his own thing. I think that that relationship, it's kind of like the unresolved personal relationship Batman would like to have with his son. He would love to have had a son. He would love to have had a family. But he never did. He couldn't. He couldn't have that normal life. So Lauren was and is a very great partner to have worked with. He's a great guy. And it helped me a lot. I don't know what more I can say about Robin.
Thank you.
Sure. Take care.